Hi there. My name is Satvik, and I'm going to talk about rewriting pieces of a Python codebase in Julia. So why would you want to do this? Basically, it's when you already have a Python codebase and you want to rewrite some slow parts. So I work at a company called Temple, and we were pretty much in exactly that situation. We had several years of NumPy-heavy Python code that had been written, you know, both by engineers and non-engineers. And it was great for research, but we had some batch jobs which were very slow and very expensive. Even when we ran these on, say, 100 machines, it would still take about 8 hours and cost quite a bit of money. And since this was important, we'd already spent a lot of time just focused on optimizing it. And I mean, we had managed to make it noticeably faster, three times faster, but we'd still kind of hit diminishing returns. And we really wanted to be able to run many, many more pipelines than this. So basically, we tried rewriting in a few different things. Since we had Python, we wanted something that integrates easily with it. So Cython and Numba were kind of easy sells from their pitch. They're basically supposed to be more restricted Python or Python with some C. Julia was a harder pitch, but I just really wanted to try it out. So I went and did it. And the end result was sort of within a few days of work, we had a working Julia version that was already faster than the optimized Python version. Meanwhile, we still did not have a working Cython or Numba version. It turned out that despite these languages supposedly integrating with Python, they use a very restricted subset of features. And we made some significant efforts, but could not get it to work. And then the short version is, it's 6 months later now, we've rewritten several pipelines in Julia. Again, all of these were already written in NumPy, already fairly optimized. And you know, you're seeing like 28x or 8x or 14x improvements. So here is an example of what calling Julia code from Python looks like. It looks pretty sane. You know, you're doing your normal sort of importing NumPy, then there's some boilerplate to start up a Julia process. That highlighted section using my package colon my square is just the Julia equivalent of from my package import my square. So that's what we're doing here. We've got this array that we generated in Python using NumPy, just 1, 2, 3. And then we call our square function, which is a Julia function in our own custom Julia package. And that will return actually a NumPy array. And the reason for that is because the libraries underlying this, PyCall and PyJulia, are sort of smart enough to share that array, that contiguous piece of memory between Julia and NumPy, and recognize that it's the same data structure. For an example on the other side, here's a case where this is Julia code that's calling Python. So what we're doing here is we're importing pandas as well as one of our own libraries, file utils. Then we're just reading a CSV, which creates a Python data frame in pandas, converting that data frame using the Python function to arrow, and then taking that arrow byte array, which since it's an array, it can easily be shared between Python and Julia now, and converting that to a Julia data frame. And you'll notice that pd.readcsv, myfile.csv, that looks exactly the same as it would look in Python. This is Julia code, but the two languages can have some very similar syntax. So kind of the most important part, in my view, of how these libraries work is by sharing and converting the underlying data. So PyCall and PyJulia are able to sort of just like translate scalar values like integers, floats, strings directly. They can also translate some collections directly like dicts and tuples. Both languages have these concepts. Arrays, so Python lists will get converted to Julia arrays as well as NumPy arrays. And that means that if you do a round trip, like from a Python list to a Julia array and then back, you'll actually wind up with a NumPy array. That's usually fine, but that's just one little thing to watch out for. And then this one is trickier. Python's name tuple and subclasses will get converted directly to a plain tuple in Julia. This actually bit us a little bit because we were using subclasses of name tuples for several things. So when you do that, you just have to make sure that you prevent the automatic conversion, which the syntax for that varies, but basically you add an O at the end. And then data frames, there's no automatic conversion, but as you just saw, you can use Apache Arrow to convert data frames from Python to Julia and back. So the hardest part of this is actually the setup. Once you've got things set up, as you saw, the code is kind of simple. It's relatively easy to use. So you just need to watch out for a few things. And these are the things I ran into. So when you're using Python, PyJulia with an existing Python environment, which probably most of you are if you've been using Python for a while, you need to either turn off pre-compilation in Julia or launch code with this utility, python-jl, instead of just launching like python myfile.py, you write python-jl myfile.py. Similarly, another kind of nasty thing is it doesn't naturally capture standard output from Julia. So you can get around this by just logging your output to a text file. Then on the other side, to use PyCall with a Python environment, you just need to build it with the environment. That's not very hard. You just need to set a variable and then rebuild. It can be over aggressive in converting, like I just mentioned with name tuples. So there are a few ways to prevent automatic conversion. And that's what you'll usually want to do if you're importing your own Python class. You don't want it to get stripped of information by mistake. Last thing, there's some trickiness around PyCall's imports. They have to be done in the same module that they're used. Again, that's pretty easy to take care of once you know it. So just check the documentation really quickly. But once you have that, you should be fine. And if you have any questions, feel free to email me. Thank you.